Table was full, and somebody shouted for some request. And so we played Danny Boy, and Steve played it, and Terry sang it. And during the number, I was sitting playing the drums and watching, and there was one particular table, and everybody at it was crying, you know, during the song. They were really crying and upset. And when the show was over, I went over to sit, I said, I couldn't help but notice, I said, excuse me, I couldn't help but notice that you were very emotional during Danny Boy, i.e. Irish. They said, no, we're musicians.
Happy birthday, dear DC.
It may not be obvious to you, but these men are heartthrobs. And I'm not talking cardiac arrest here, folks. A quarter of a century has passed since they unleashed themselves on our ancestors, and we want to know why.
Sorry, that's going back until 19... the 50s, right? I think it was 1955, 54. Sean Lucy and myself were playing with a band called Chris O'Brien. We used to play in Latin. And we were very keen on jazz at that time. So, that particular band wasn't playing enough Dixieland for our liking, so we decided to form our own band. And we got T.O. Cal, who was an exponent on the trombone. And we got together, we had a meeting, and we decided we would form a band. And Shandon Boat Club, I think at the time, was it Sean Shandon?
Yeah.
They were looking for a band. Jazz was becoming very popular that time again. So we did an audition for them in the RH Hall. And there was only three of us turned up for the audition. So, clarinet, trombone and drums. And we got the audition and we got the contract to start playing in Shandon Boat Club on Sunday nights. And at that time I was an apprentice upholsterer in Cashes. Sean was a radio engineer and T.O. was in the SB as a messenger boy. Well, he was not. He was several. We were all apprentices. So we started playing on a Sunday night, 8 to 11. No amplification. And there was five of us in the band. And we got a fiver, it was a pound a man, which was big money, because I was working in Cashes for 19 shillings for a week. The type of music we wanted to sort of be more or less working then, the age went off, the trad scene, it faded out a little bit, and the big thing on the way was rock and roll. Started making a big impression, rock and roll was. So we were able to change because we had the saxophone players, we had baritone, tenor, we were able to follow any record that came out at that time, started with feature saxophone. With electric guitar. Steve Lynch joined the band and he had electric guitar. He was the only one in Cork that had electric guitar. He still has it. Right? At that time, there was only two strings on it. And he practiced hard, now he can play four. And next year, he's going for the fifth string. It's a five. But we were able to copy, which was the name. That's where show bands became sort of popular. We weren't purists. We followed the popular music and copied the records.
There you go, baby, weird, and now will you let me hear so I could sit and cry? Well, golly gee, what have you done to me? Oh, well, I guess it doesn't matter anymore.
Music madness and crazy characters galore. Sax player Sean Lucy.
I can sincerely say that Joe Mack is the craziest character I've run across, you know. But we met different people. In different bands, some very good bands came to Arcadian Cork. They were very funny people. They were the Witnesses now. They were a very funny band. Johnny Quigley. Of course, the Clippers were the gods. Clippers were the men. Everybody copied the Clippers. You know, you'd live alone just to go and see the Clippers. And then when we got the job in Arcadia to play every Saturday night with the Clippers and all the bands come in, That was a great trip. You know. We always did comedy because we had Joe. Joe's a natural comedian. Even when he played the drums at the very start when we played Tread, Joe always did some comedy song or he did some comedy routine, always. And one of the big things then were drum solos, you know, and every band used to have to play a drum solo. And then Joe used to play the drum solo and throw the sticks, hop the sticks, hit his head and everything. And he was natural, you see. But that was comedy, and then any funny record that ever came out, so we just did it.
But it wasn't all drum madness and comedy. The Dixies had many hit singles, including cover versions of US hits. When the Beatles were about to score 7 consecutive number ones, the Dixies made their first trip to the USA. In 1970, the Beatles broke up, and the Dixies were back again in the United States, this time in Las Vegas. Theo Kell.
Vegas, 1970, that was the peak of our 60s era, really, if you put it. Now, when we went into Vegas, we went in with an open mind. We didn't know what to expect, but within a short few weeks, we became top show in the act in the Desert Inn Hotel. That was in 1970. They brought us back again for a second term, and what was the most amazing thing out there was that the second term coming back at the airport in Vegas, all of the friends we gathered together in the first session, they were all there to meet us with a big Kid Miller Feuchter, a big banner that was stretched about 20 feet, and they were there, about 500 of them, in the airport waiting for us, which was fantastic, really.
Vegas was very good to us in other ways, too. Gave us lots of memories. We met people, here we have people like Joe Brown and Ralph Harris, and here we've got an early photograph of Dusty Springfield. Here she is with Sean Lucy. And then we had here Robert Goulet and Leslie Nielsen. And that was kind of a after-show drink that we'd have.
Steve Lynch, keeper of the flame. In 1972, the Dixies followed another 60s trend. They broke up. But 10 years later, they found themselves yet again strange bedfellows. This time, the star was in the East.
When Abu Dhabi came up, and a guy walked into me one day and said, would you play the Middle East? And I thought he was crazy. We had just made a comeback after being retired, and we were negotiating at the time a trip to America, and this guy said, would you be interested in playing the Middle East? And I said, built there. And he said, Abu Dhabi and Dubai. And I said, oh, yeah. I said, well. And I gave him a smart answer. I said, well, we're sort of doing a tour of the moon first, and then maybe. And he persisted, and he was looking for videos and records and releases. And I humored him. And I said, we would. And eventually we heard, and our management communicated, and we got contracts to sign, and then we were in the middle of the Middle East.
It 1986, 25 years on, so what about the Dixies? Will they keep going?
I think the band will keep going as long as we have the same comradeship, the same love for music, the same professional dedication that we've put into it all of the years that we've been together.
One or two changes, like when I take the big records of the bands had out now, like the Royal Showman and the Hucklebuck, I'd like to have that before then. And different, you know, we could change it that little bit.
Well, we all hope to try to keep at it now. Because when you look back and see the times that we weren't doing it, there was definitely something missing.